Alex Vaughn.
What's up?
Welcome to Not 97.
Thanks for having me.
Welcome to New York.
Yes.
How you feeling?
I'm feeling good. You know, I was at my first Vogue ball last night, and it was a lot of fun, but I didn't get home till 5 a.m., so yeah. I'm loving how New York's kind of like turning me up little by little and a lot by a lot.
Fresh off tour, or are still on tour?
Yes, we have 6 more shows left. This is a 34-date tour, and we have 2 shows in New York, and then our last 4 in D.C.
Yeah, and supporting Ari Lennox.
Yes.
Safe to say your biggest tour yet?
This is my first tour.
First tour.
Yeah, so first and biggest.
Yeah,
thus
how does
far.
It feel?
It's incredible. Like, I love performing. I love my job. I love the fact that Ari is just super sweet and just so talented and just makes the space comfortable. And I just been learning and growing. And they were both in the same area. So it's just like, it's a special synergy on the road.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you feel like you like tour life?
Oh, I love tour life. Now, I will say it's been a bit of an adjustment, you know, like knowing how to keep myself sane when on the road for, like, you know, weeks at a time, or just how to preserve my energy. But overall, I love, like, touching new cities and performing for new crowds and just learning how to, like, tweak and freak my set and just make it better. I love it.
Yeah. So originally from PG County.
I am.
And spent some time, I guess D.C. is basically right there.
Yeah, they're, like, right next door. They're cousins.
I know that coming up, that kind of community was very big for you.
Yes.
And I read that you had, like, started a live open mic series.
Yeah, it's called AV Sessions.
That's still going on.
Yes, we started it in 2018, and it's been about 5 years strong. It's the third Wednesday of every month. It takes place in Northeast D.C., and it's just a safe space for any creatives from the area to come in and just perform and just get their 10,000 hours and just kind of build their tribe. And we have a live house band there. And they just perform, and anybody can go up and do their thing.
So how important was, like, that community for you coming up, and how important is that community for you now?
Oh, it's extremely important, because I remember being an artist, you know, trying to get performance experience, but it felt like it was clicky. And that's a thing that I always hear in people's areas, like, oh, man, like, the scene is just clicky. I don't know how to get in. And I didn't want to force myself into a space. So I was like, let me just find a way to create my own. And, you know, just piece by piece and just with little conversations and setbacks, it just kind of... it turned into AV Sessions, and I want for everyone to have an opportunity to you know, to build their chops.
Yeah.
Yeah, and make, like I said, make their own tribe. I think it's very important. Community is super important.
Yeah. I didn't even realize until you said it that the next run of shows is D.C., so it's kind of your homecoming.
Yeah. So when Ari announced the tour, she had 2 D.C. shows, and they sold out immediately. So then she added 2 more. And they sold out, too. So the last 4 shows are going to be homecoming shows. I'm really excited.
That's exciting. Feels like a full circle.
I know. It's wild. You know, like, this whole, the crowds in D.C., like, these are the people I grew up performing around. These are the people I went to middle school and high school around. You know, that's my community. So to be able to perform in front of them, it's, like, it's super full circle. And at this capacity,
I've heard you describe your music as kind of feel-good life music.
Mm-hmm.
And I see kind of in your visuals, there's a tendency to kind of just show life happening, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you're hanging out with your girls and talking, like, and so be it. You're driving around, you're going to the amusement park. I wonder, like, if you think about... I've been curious of, like, the context in which where we listen and how we listen to music, and I wonder if you kind of think about that, of, like, where people are listening, where people are living with your music.
Yeah, you know, I think when I started getting these experiences that made me start writing about these songs, like, it wasn't like I wasn't doing anything extravagant, and it's not an extravagant feeling. You know, it's just a very human emotion to just know that things are changing, and I wanted it to just be as natural as possible and for people to know that, like, you can experience this at any time in any space in your life, whether I mean, I didn't plan for it to be like that deep, but you know, for real, yeah. like it, you can listen to it and you can take this in any time, in any place, in any space. Yeah, I didn't want it to be too crazy because it's just human and regular and it happens. Yeah. So I wanted people to just kind of like experience it the same way.
Your music is very often very vulnerable, often very emotional. And in saying that, you put a lot of yourself kind of on record. What has that, has that always been your writing style? And what has that process been for you to kind of like get comfortable sharing that vulnerability with people?
So when I first started writing music, it came from a place of like me not feeling like I was being taken seriously. So when I would write, it would always be like my most vulnerable because I felt like it was where I was the most understood. And that was just a natural thing. Just that was just how I expressed myself. But then as I started to like progress, people were like, oh my God, like, yo, you really said something. Or when I got signed, I was like, you know, recording and writing new music, and they're like, you got to dig a little deeper. So I was like, damn. But it was a very painful process, and it can still be a little painful, but I think there's a beauty in like owning your vulnerability. And I think that's just kind of like the objective of just, you know, my life and just, you know, my music and the Hurtbook. Like, you can, once you like take power over your moments, then, you know, you can play around with them. Like, you know, you can joke about them, you can laugh about them, you can cry and stop crying. You know, you just taking the power back.
Yeah. That's a life lesson.
Yes.
Beyond just a creative lesson.
Absolutely.
I know even before the Hurtbook, like kind of speaking of showing your vulnerability, your voice notes EP is literally like raw voice notes.
Those are literal voice memos.
What is that like, getting to a point where you're comfortable showing people that?
Oh, it was painful. It was so painful because, you know, all the songs that I create, like I'll say a strong 90% of the songs that I create start off as a voice memo with myself and piano. And when I'm doing the voice memo, it's because, one, I'm not in a studio and I just need to get the idea out. And for the most part, the voice memos kind of stay voice memos. Like, I don't know what to do with them. I don't really know if I want to elevate it. I just wanted to get the emotions off for that. Like, I kind of wanted to leave it alone. But, you know, when I got signed, we were just playing music and, you know, just everything and my team and their favorites. And they started mentioning some voice memos and they were old songs. And I just felt like they were just garbage and bleh. But it was really a testament to show that, like, you know, this music is timeless and it doesn't speak to just you. And once you create a song, you know, it doesn't even belong to you anymore. So to see that people were like responding to these old ass songs, it felt good. And it helped me gain comfort in these stories, that stuff that I was trying to like forget about, for real, for real.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's also like an added intimacy of it almost feeling like a live record. Mm-hmm. I mean, because it ultimately is a live record.
Yeah.
Did that like inspire you to at all to be like, maybe I could lean in more on live recordings and kind of like more stripped down, you know, releasing more stripped down versions or just even more stripped down songs in general?
Well, as just being a musician, I love stripped down anything. I love writing to loops. I love working with musicians. So, and then, you know, when I first started creating music, like that is how I started, just my voice and the keys. So I grew up with stripped down. Yes. Yeah. So I would never be opposed to it.
Yeah. I know that historically you've, you know, written almost all of your own music.
Mm-hmm.
And is it fair to say like that with the Hurtbook is the first, maybe not the first time, but like bringing in more songwriters and producers and stuff to be around you?
I would definitely say that the Hurtbook was like my first time collaborating with other writers.
Yeah.
And it's not because I was like opposed to working with other people. I just think for a long time I had this warped thought process that, you know, you weren't a good artist if you weren't writing everything yourself. You know what I'm saying? Like, I looked up to people who actually did write everything by themselves, like Stevie Wonder and Amy Winehouse. And then I realized, no, like, the greatest art is when you kind of, like, collaborate with other people. So I still enjoy writing things myself, and I want to have my hands on everything. But, like, you know, when you realize people, like, have skills and they got the vibe and we have the skill set and the vibe, and that combination together just births something completely new, a whole new perspective. And I would never shy away from a potential new thing. So it's been great. I love collaborating with other artists. I love teamwork.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that. I also think I've talked to I had a conversation with an artist a few days ago about that, of like being very precious about your work and writing it all yourself, and then like getting to a point where you're like, I have so many incredible people around me.
Yeah.
Let me let them in.
Yeah, because I mean, like, I only know what I know, and you just sometimes know that this can go somewhere else. I just don't know. And all it takes sometimes is somebody to be like, go that way. Or butter, and that's the missing word, you know, that you've been looking for the song. And that's just so valuable. It's not a contest of who wrote the most or who is more, it's just vibes and people just being creative and just collaborating together. And once that objective is just to make some great art, it just becomes even more fun and even a little bit easier than when you're writing by yourself.
Yeah.
Because you get to a point when you're writing a song sometimes and you don't know, like I said, you don't know where to go with the next line, and you just kind of have to leave the song alone. Or you try to bust your brain trying to figure it out, and that can all be alleviated if you just work with your peers.
Yeah. I mean, you had some legendary icons in the studio with you. I'm wondering what you learned from people like that, like working with Rodney. And
man, I think the biggest thing I learned is to be myself and just be free. You know, when you get into these higher positions, you kind of feel like you got to be doing something differently. Like you got to do something better. Like something has to change. I don't know if there's like an immediate switch where you turn into this superstar or whatever. But I went to the space and realized that like we're already these people. And if we just sit in that pocket and just like accept and embrace who we are and where we are, then things just start to flow, you know? And I'm a person, like many people, who can sometimes have imposter syndrome or feel like, I can't be doing this right. Like, there's got to be more I could be doing. Am I enough? And I don't know. It was just like a reminder, like, yeah, you are. It was a nice reiteration, especially from a great like Rodney Jerkins. Yeah. It's so funny because what made Rodney Jerkins and I work together, he heard another voice note, a song that I swear I would never want it to see or hear ever again.
And you didn't know it was being sent to him.
I did not know it was being sent to him. I had written the song in like 2013 or 2014. Like it was just an old song. And that song was sent to him. I didn't know. And he loved it and he wanted to work. And I was like, I'm just confused. Like, I trust Rodney Jerkins and his taste levels, but like, why does he like this song? And then that's when I had to realize, like, you know, Alex, you might be in your way a little bit. Like, but yeah, it just, I think working with Rodney Jerkins and all the creatives that I've worked with, it's just like, Alex, just sit in your pocket and do you. That's how you got here. Just doing you and being yourself.
Yeah. You know, speaking of collaborators, you just dropped the bonus Homegirl pack.
I did.
Featuring remixes and joints with Ari Lennox, Summer Walker, Muni Long. How important was it for you to highlight these women on these remixes?
Oh, it was super important to me. For starters, you know, there's always been like this stigma about the industry and how, you know, women are pitted against each other and we don't work together and we don't support each other. And it's just not true. I just want it to be deaded. And, you know, there's also like this narrative about R&B being dead. And it's just like, no, it's not. And there are I have so many talented and beautiful friends and know so many talented and beautiful women who just kill it all the time. And I just wanted them to be highlighted and to just show that we can join forces and be superheroes together. And on top of that, I'm like real fans of all three of them. So it was just an honor that they even took the time out to like share their gifts with me. And,
yeah, I was going to say, what does that mean to you? Kind of like to have them on that.
I felt like, you know, it was just like a stamp, not only to, you know, the fact that we, you know, see each other and believe in each other's gifts, but just like, just a stamp that like, you know, we can do this together. And it doesn't have to be we're joining forces and being sad and being hurt or whatever the case is. Like, we can join forces and grow and encourage other people to grow and to grow with their village, or, you know what I'm saying? Just not doing it alone.
Yeah. You know, obviously, with Ari specifically, you've been with her every night on the tour.
Yeah.
I guess, how has that relationship grown, both kind of personally and creatively, and kind of what have you learned from watching her on tour?
So Ari has been super incredible. She's been super sweet and super thoughtful. Like, you know, we're at work, so we're not, like, you know, sitting at the cafeteria table really able to, like, talk to each other as much. But, like, every time we cross paths, whether it's, like, shooting a text message or on Instagram, like, she just checks in, makes sure we're still feeling comfortable. You know, this is a sold-out tour of hers. You know what I'm saying? You know, I want to know what do you do to stick, and what are you doing that people are so obsessed? And she's just being authentically herself and just making music that feels true to her, and people just love authenticity. And, you know, it just helps me and encourages me to just, like, you know, stand more in my authenticity and just how to preserve myself, my mental, and while on the road, because there's a lot of just variables happening. You know, singing is the easy part for most singers.
Yeah.
And it's the offstage things that kind of, like, can tire you out or warp you. So, you know, she's been on tours before and, you know, she's has more experience. So she's always able to just give some advice or just give some insight or just empathize that she's gone through the same things as well, which really does help.
Yeah.
You know, to just know that you're not alone in these experiences. And it's really, like, helped me to, like, be a better leader. You know, I have so many people who are asking me questions now because they're seeing me on stage. And I realize, like, some of the questions they ask are questions that I ask, or some of the things that they may be projecting are the ways that I may project. So it kind of helps me to, like, kind of tone it down and just, like, regulate what kind of an example I want to set, if that makes sense.
Yeah, yeah, 100%.
Shout out to Ari.
100%. I mean, that, I think that authenticity is interesting, especially, like, bigger stages that you get on. And I wonder, like, if you, how do you think about that? And is there a difference between the Alex Vaughn that lives on stage and the Alex Vaughn that's off stage?
You know, crazy enough, I'm trying to figure out how to differentiate the two because they're very similar. I will say, when I get on stage, I'm probably my freest because I can't undo anything. I can't backspace. I can't recut. I can't. It's just, you just free. Like, you just, I just go on airplane mode. And I think when I'm comfortable, it just makes other people comfortable, and we just vibe out, and I feel very in control and just very confident. And when I'm off stage, I'm also confident. I'm just a sleepier version. I'm the same. Like, I love just connecting with people. I love exchanging energy. But I'd say the biggest difference is that I'd be sleepy when I get off stage.
That's all good. So to finish the interview, if you'd be so kind to introduce one of your own songs. It could be any song that you want. It can be new, it could be old, and just let us know kind of why you chose that song, what that song means, and then introduce it.
Okay. Right, just one of the songs. The song that I like to introduce is a song of mine called Good Morning featuring my sis Ab Mojo. I put it out in 2017. It was probably, like, one of the first singles I put out. I had put out a project in 2015, but I wasn't really able to promote it the way, I didn't know what I was doing, in a nutshell. And this single is kind of a song that started, like, getting attention from people in my area. And the song's about just not giving up, because there are great things on the other side, and you discover new things when you get off the ground. And I feel like that is just a common theme in life because you things get tough and you do want to stop. But every time that you see a new day, you know it's an opportunity to do it a little bit better. And I like this song because I wrote it. And because it doesn't feel as like sad and mopey as the subject matter. And I think that's fun. And it's called Good Morning. So, and it's morning. So, like, good morning. What's up? It's your girl, Alex Vaughn, and you're about to hear my song, Good Morning, featuring Odd Mojo on Not 97.
Boom. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
Find it out, you fall so. So don't you, don't think about, don't think of ending. Cause it just might be a new beginning. Each day you wake up, you know there's tomorrow. So won't you open your eyes, open your eyes.
Sent them a text saying good morning. I don't know why I keep forcing it. I mean, it's just boring and I can't help the morning. Feeling like the reminiscing, blocking new beginnings. There's a bigger picture, like looking in the mirror. Starting to get clear, man. Already a winner. More like a zipper jammed than a beat that needs to be released. Somebody pass me the sheets. I think I'm about to get deep on them. Let me preach to him. You're here for a reason, so don't you think of leaving. Cause grieving is the smolder when you're passing near me. I hope you live more in the moment than what you appear to be. Stop living in a disguise, just open your eyes for all your wish you decide, even your pride. I even tried multiple times, I was denied. I just never gave up, just stop, wait, no, never reply.
It's a brand new day, it's a brand new day. So push the pain away, push the pain, push the pain away. And it's gonna be okay, so we can celebrate.